안녕하세요, 피타입니다. 2020년 주총 중에 원유 가격 폭락과 관련된 질의응답이 있었습니다. 이번에는 설명할 내용이 좀 있어서 질문 먼저 빠르게 듣고 오시겠습니다.
Both a Berkshire and Occidental shareholder, I was encouraged to see your investment in the company. But with passing weeks, it became evident that your investment facilitated Occidental management's ability to avoid a shareholder vote on the Anadarko acquisition, a very shareholder-unfriendly outcome. This deal proved to be irresponsible and expensive from an Oxy perspective, and ultimately very value-destructive for Oxy shareholders. In my view, it also permanently hurt Berkshire's reputation in the marketplace. Please comment on this unfortunate outcome and tell me why Oxy shareholders and other market observers shouldn't feel this way.
Occidental이라는 회사는 셰일 오일 업체로 버크셔의 전환 상환 우선주로 발행한 자금으로 경쟁사인 아나다코를 인수했습니다. 당시 쉐브론에 인수될 것을 위약금을 물었고 아마도 주총 승인 없이 진행된 듯합니다. 그리고 최근 유가가 폭락하면서 옥시덴탈은 자금난에 빠지게 되는 상황이 오면서 결과적으로 버크셔가 꼬드겨서 옥시덴탈이 이런 위기가 온 것이 아닌가 하는 그런 다소 까칠한 질문이 아닌가 싶습니다. 압박 질문에 답하는 과정에서 유가와 관련된 뷰를 많이 보여주는 듯하니 이제 버핏의 답변 한번 들어보시겠습니다.
Well, we said right from the beginning, although we didn't certainly expect to agree to it, what's happened. We said essentially when you buy into an oil, a huge oil production company, you know, how it works out is going to depend on the price of oil to a great extent. It is a investment that depends on the price of oil. And, you know, when oil goes to minus $37, it happened the other day for I guess it was the May contract, you know, that's off the chart. And if you own oil, you should only own oil if you expect these prices to go up significantly. I don't know whether they'll go up significantly or not. We're in the transaction. Our commitment was made on a Sunday when the management of Anadarko favored Chevron, and Chevron had a breakup fee of $1 billion, and Occidental people have been working on it for several years, and it was attractive at oil prices that then prevailed. And it doesn't work, obviously. It doesn't work at $20 a barrel. Certainly doesn't work at minus $37 a barrel, but it doesn't work at $20 a barrel. And everything the oil companies have been doing, whether it's Exxon or Occidental or anybody else, it doesn't work at these oil prices. That's why oil production is going to go down a lot in the next few years, because it does not pay to drill. Now, that's happened at other times in the past, but the situation is, you know, you don't know where you're going to store the incremental barrel of oil, and oil demand is down dramatically, and for a while the Russians and the Saudis were trying to outdo each other in how much oil they could produce. And when you've got too much in storage, it doesn't work its way off that very fast. Now, you will have production of oil go down in the United States significantly. It does not pay to drill in all kinds of formations that it paid before, and it doesn't pay to have paid the price that oil was trading at in the ground a year or two ago. And to that extent, if you're an Oxy shareholder, you know, you've, or any shareholder in any oil producing company, you join me in having made a mistake so far in terms of where oil prices went, and who knows where they go in the future.
Let me follow up with this one then. This one comes in from Manish Bal, who says, is there a risk of permanent loss of capital in the oil equity investments?
Well, there certainly is. You know, there's no question. If oil stays at these prices, there's going to be a lot of money, a whole lot of money, and it'll extend to bank loans, and it'll affect the banking industry to some degree. Not, it doesn't destroy them or anything, but it there's a lot of money that's been invested that was not invested based on a $17 or $20 or $25 price for WTI, West Texas Intermediate Oil. And but you can do the same thing in copper. You can do the same thing in some of the things we manufacture. I mean, but with commodities, it's particularly dramatic. And, you know, farmers have been getting lousy prices, but to some extent, the government subsidizes them. I'm all for it, actually. But if you're an oil producer, you take your chances on future prices, unless you want to sell a lot of futures forward. Oxy actually did sell 300,000 barrels a day of puts, in effect, that or they bought puts but and sold calls, in effect, to match it. And they were protected on at $10 for a layer of $10 a barrel on 300,000 barrels a day. But you're really buying, when you buy oil, you're betting on oil prices over time and over a long time. And oil prices, there's risk. And the risk is being realized by oil producers as we speak. There will be, if these prices prevail, there will be a lot of bad loans and energy loans and bad debts and energy loans. And if there are bad debts and energy loans, you can imagine what happens to the equity holders. So, yes, there's risk.
배경 설명을 듣고 답변을 들으니 좀 더 잘 이해가 되실 겁니다. 압박 질문이다 보니 적극적인 해명 과정에서 버핏의 뷰가 많이 드러나는 느낌이 있습니다. 특히 쉐일 오일 기업에 투자하는 것이 유가에 대한 투자가 일부 반영되어 있음을 알 수 있고, 기업이 아닌 원유 자체에 투자하는 것은 버핏 관점에서는 도박성 투기에 가깝다고 보는 것 같습니다. 마지막 대목에 대해서 멤버십 분께서 질문을 주셨는데 같이 한번 들어보시겠습니다.
영상의 마지막 부분이 조금 어려운데요. 유가 하락으로 인한 부도의 위험도 있지만 유가가 정상화될 때까지 변동성을 견뎌낼 여력은 어느 정도 있다 라고 이해해도 괜찮을까요?
미소사랑님 좋은 질문 감사드리고 답변은 예스라고 보실 수 있습니다. 한 발 더 나가서 해석해보면 저유가가 장기화되면 에너지 정크 채권이 문제가 생겨서 금융시장에도 타격을 줄 수 있다고 경계하는 의미로 해석할 수 있습니다. 이번에는 내용이 조금 어려웠지만 알찬 내용이었던 것 같습니다. 댓글로 응원과 피드백 남겨주시면 이후 에피소드에 큰 힘이 될 것으로 봅니다. 이상 피터왕이었습니다.